as we slowly open up the economy, I think there's a promise that if we continue that momentum of embracing technology, right, we will all rise up to this challenge. 2020 was heralded as a decade of new possibilities and hope. Yet recent events in the past months have been a strong blow to businesses across sectors. We understand that you have all felt the disruption and in fact have made significant strides on all aspects of your operations in order to adapt. Such downturns drive businesses all over the world to relook at their current operations to minimize impact, trim off inefficiencies, hone organizational excellence, and plan for a rebound in the future. To maintain top-line growth, you cut costs. Find new sources of revenues, optimize product SKUs, and new business models to adapt to the evolving customer needs and sentiments with the best position to take advantage of new market and growth opportunities. They continue to invest in innovation and build agility to their value chain to ensure that they can operate without disruption and scale up or down their operations in accordance to demand. In other words, they became interconnected businesses in four areas: customers, employees, insights, and processes.
A significantly a lot more control on the internal than the external. And what we want to do is that prepare ourselves internally so that these externalities will move. We know will move. It's not gonna ripple effect into our operations as much.
How can enterprises collaborate more with their suppliers? How can the goods receipt person in the warehouse collaborate more with the accounts payable for a team in Manila? Collaboration is a topic before the pandemic, and now it's still a topic, but heightened depth or heightened interest or more depth. Specifically, customers, right, our customers, the ones that we speak with very actively, they do not just want to collaborate with their suppliers. Right now, they want to collaborate with their supplier's supplier, right? They don't just want to collaborate with their customers or their distributors. Now, they're more concerned about, okay, so I already know what my distributors are doing. How about my distributor's customer or my distributor's customer's customer?
On the supply chain strategy specifically, what we needed to do was to create this internal cycle of establishing effective structures and faster response. And this one is being able to at least have the right data at the right time and having access. We needed to enhance our skill set in data analytics because now, more than ever, we need to be able to access the data and not only access the data, but analyze the data so that we can make decisions remotely. And a more integration with our customers and suppliers. So having that transparency means also not just being able to talk to them, but actually being able to see and communicate our systems with them. Simplify our end-to-end processes, that's always a given, and increase risk management capabilities. This one is actually much more an issue right now, especially with security concerns. So our digital transformation actually allowed us to optimize certain operations and future processes. We already adopted a digitized platform because it was very difficult for us to operate in 22 factories in 10 countries. We didn't have that digitized back end to begin with. You can't be a Walmart if your structure is a sari-sari store. So we made that call at that time that we were going to be a Walmart. We were not just going to be a sari-sari store in the Philippines. And so that started our journey. And I'm happy to say that because we have that digitized backend already integrated in our process, just the pushing it up now to data analytics, integrating other facets of the operations and other parts of the supply chain clear across to our suppliers and our customers makes it a little bit more easier for us. That's something that I think is not just going to be in vogue during the pandemic, but post-pandemic will be even much more important because we're going to realize that transition to the new normal will show that that will be the backbone of how businesses will run rather than how it was in the past.
And in a world that is interconnected now more than ever, we are witnessing a shift in the power to shape brands from the hands of marketing departments in companies to the social media feeds and networks of our customers. And this notion that the consumer has much more influence over your brand than your own company does emphasizes the imperative to focus on delivering an authentic and superior customer experience in order to be able to win the hearts of our customers. And everyone is asking if these new behaviors are going to stick around in what we're calling the next normal. To attempt to find an answer to this, I think what we should be asking is, do the new ways offer a good experience? And are those new experiences more rewarding than the behaviors they replaced? Well, the answer to these questions will play a big role in determining if the present norms are here to stay. We recognize that in a world where customer preferences are ever-changing, we needed to be driven by principles and values and not be married to the specifics of how we delivered them, as that would need to change over time. A transformation like this needs to be holistic so that you can deliver an authentic and consistent experience across all channels and customer interactions. At Union Bank, we got started by focusing on two of the most important foundations of any transformation: people and technology. We said that we need to change how we do things as we want to be a great retail bank, but we need to pivot that strategy and focus on achieving this aspiration by delivering a superior customer experience powered by an organization that is digital to the core. In a CX transformation, the most important change that needs to happen is in people's mindsets and how the organization is structured. So we started by spending time convincing our people of why the change needed to happen. Why do we care so much about and have to focus on them to successfully transform? Because what happens inside our company and how our people feel, how they are empowered, is felt in the end by the customer. Think of each person in your organization as a musician in an orchestra. Everyone plays a different instrument and has to be on the same page, with an understanding of the value they add to the piece, listening to each other to make the beautiful music happen.
We live by these core values, that is entrepreneurial mindset, stewardship, and integrity. And these core values influence our day-to-day decisions and our long-term goals. The entrepreneurial mindset specifically has helped us quickly shift gears to the new normal. So what I did was really pivot the team to business partnership, commercial finance, and financial planning and insights. It's not easy, but then, you know, it's a 360-degree change that, you know, you have to do, not just overnight, but over the next 3 years or so. My finance team last year was very much at the forefront of the business, because if you understand the business, you would know how to, you know, cut costs at the time of the pandemic. They were the ones supporting the business in negotiating for store rental, in preserving cash, ensuring that we have the right collections, etc. So there's a lot of things that goes into like transforming the finance team, but it's all about supporting the business at the end of the day. And I guess that's where the right, you know, mix of the right and the left mind of a CFO, so to speak. While you have to have your left brain to be so into cost cutting, right? Hey, you can expand, you have to cut costs. But at the same time, hey, you know, we need to launch our e-commerce. We need to drive e-commerce and support that as well. What are the other things that can drive growth? What are the categories that are selling well? So we all have support, we have to support those categories that are still growing. So I guess it has to be a balance, and I think it's all about practice and really understanding what's happening in the business. We continue to be on the lookout for M&A opportunities. So what we're looking at businesses that complements our formats. So that's across supermarkets, DIY drugstores, you know, etc. And of course, on e-commerce. What's important is that it will drive top line. It's margin accretive. And it will expand our presence across the country, because we believe that there's still a lot of, you know, uncharted territories or locations across the country.